Very nice.
Empty spaces, what are we living for? Abandoned places.
Ron Dante,
I guess we know.
That music, evidently that music tope didn't work.
Yeah,
did it?
We tried.
We tried to do something a little different. The Voice of Archie, 1969. Where are you going with that? Stop the tape, please. Thank you.
Yeah.
The Voice of Archie, 1969.
Yes, that's right. Number one record of the year. Sugar, Sugar. I did it when I was a kid, and it continues to get played every day. I was the voice of the Archies.
I just couldn't believe you were just saying Staten Island.
Yes.
Grew up in Staten Island. Yes. Great singers, great people come from Staten Island.
It was a very rich atmosphere. Lots of my whole family sang. All my uncles sang. Uh-huh. Nobody did it professionally. I was the only one to really make a profession of it. But I was very lucky. I got a great launching, and I was only across the bay from the Brill Building and Manhattan.
Oh, that was my building, Brill Building.
Yeah.
Tell me about growing up in New York City as a young singer. You're just a young singer, and people like Vic DeMonte and knew Bobby Darin. You knew Bobby Darin at that time.
That's right.
Tell me about that.
Well, I was lucky enough to be near the Brill Building. I could actually travel from Staten Island by ferry, mm-hmm. Staten Island ferry to the train, take the train up to the Brill Building area, 50th and Broadway.
A half an hour, that's it.
That's right. And I would go into the Brill Building as a young teenager with my guitar and walk up to the top floor. Or take the top floor elevator,
right,
and walk down, because it's easier to come down than it is going up. And I'd stop at every music publisher and every agent and say, would you like to hear me sing? I've written a song. And one of the people that stopped me was Bobby Darin's publishing company called TM.
TM.
They signed me to a songwriting contract, and I got to meet and work for Bobby Darin, who was just great. Of course, years before that, I had met a guy named Don Kirshner, who also I worked for, and he really gave me my start in the business.
Were you a pushy young guy at the time? And you had to be at the beginning of your career.
I was very nervous during those years. Uh-huh. I was shy, uh-huh. And I had to push myself.
That's it.
To go into those offices and meet those people. But once I got in and I could sing, I was okay. Once the guitar came out and I could sing a song for them, it was just fine.
At that age, who were your favorite singers?
Well, I grew up on the Platters.
I loved
the Platters. I loved Smoke Gets in Your Eyes. I loved all the 50s artists, and there was a duo that I grew up on that I really loved. We've spoken about this.
Right.
The Everly Brothers were really my inspiration. I love their harmonies. Yeah. I love the songs.
Pure American singers.
Perfect. And they accompany themselves perfectly on guitars. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. They were my idols, along with, of course, along with Elvis, of course, who inspired me to pick up a guitar at 13.
So you were a young, clean, wholesome singer from Staten Island, like Elvis, country boy, the Everly Brothers, same thing.
Yeah.
They're all clean, good singers who really, at that time, today we have But what do you think of the singers today? You're a producer now.
Yes,
I am. Now you are a producer.
Yeah.
You, matter of fact, discovered Barry Manilow.
Barry Manilow was I was singing a commercial. And Barry Manilow was the guy who wrote it and arranged it. And
uh-huh.
He wasn't doing anything then. He was doing some commercials. He was working with a girl at some bathhouse in New York City.
He was working at the Continental Bathhouse.
That's right.
I used to go there.
He was her piano player. Anyway, during the day, he would write commercials. And I met him on a commercial. I was hired to sing on this one commercial. Uh-huh. And there was Barry Manilow, me, Melissa Manchester, and Valerie Simpson, all doing the singing. And uh-huh. Barry at the time asked me to produce him and listen to his songs. And he played me Could It Be Magic? And that was the beginning of his career.
But your career, a Voice of Archie, that Sugar, Sugar, Sugar. My God, those songs. Who was the voice of Betty and Veronica?
Well, there was one girl who was both voices. Her name was Toni Wine.
Oh.
Very famous singer, background singer, and songwriter. Toni Wine wrote Groovy Kind of Love. Uh-huh. And Candida for Tony Orlando. She's a very talented girl. And uh-huh. She ended up doing both the voices of Betty and Veronica on, of course, on Sugar, Sugar.
Uh-huh.
She's a great singer, and she still performs around the country.
And that Archie is still around.
This is Archie's, I forget, it's the 40th anniversary of Sugar, Sugar. This year we were number one around the world with our record, and I'm so proud to be a part of it, because Archie's getting a really new look. There's all kinds of stuff going on with the Archie Comics. A new president has come in, and he's going to do a TV show, a movie, and a live show. So Archie's going to be back strong very soon.
Barry Manilow, what did you, when you first met him, tell me, what did Ron Dante do?
The first thing I thought was, this is a talented writer, arrangers I had met, because I hadn't heard him sing yet. I just heard his commercial.
Right.
I had known he had written for other products like A Good Neighbor, State Farm is there. That was his first big commercial he wrote, so I knew he could really write and arrange. But when he said, I have some real songs I'd like you to listen to, I immediately heard Could It Be Magic. That was the song he played me, the Chopin Prelude that he based the song on. And I said, this could be a Grammy Award winning singer, artist. So immediately I knew he was something special.
Copacabana, that's real special. Tell me about Copacabana.
Well, Copacabana, the first time I heard it was in Palm Springs, where Barry was living and vacationing.
Is that where
that's where he's from, and at least where he lives now. Right. And he played Copacabana at his piano, and he said, maybe we should do this like a Gene Kelly movie.
Oh,
a musical from the 50s. Uh-huh. And I thought, you know, after all our big ballads, maybe we should take it more dance. And he liked that idea. Of course, he's a brilliant arranger. So we came up with this dance arrangement for Copacabana. One thing he said to me was, if a story song hits, it's a big hit. It lasts forever. And he was right, because Copa became a movie. It's a Broadway show. It's in England as a show. It's an amazing success story.
Now, you went to England. You brought some shows from England. You're a producer. Not only a record producer, but also shows, theater. Ron, you're very busy.
Well, thank you. I try to keep expanding my career. I started off as a singer-songwriter doing demos for other people.
Right.
I became an artist with the Archies and my other groups. I became a producer with Barry and working with Cher and Pat Benatar.
What does a producer do? My audience got to know what really, the producer's usually the man who gets the money.
Yeah.
But what's this?
Well, I'm one of the creative producers. I like to get involved in the artistic part of it. I really like, in records, I always like the singer comes first, the song is very important, and then the arrangement comes after that. But I work from a singer's point of view, since I'm a singer.
Right.
So I always spotlight the voice, and that's kind of what I do. And of course, as a producer, you pay for it. Mm-hmm. But you can always find money to produce good stuff. It's the stuff that's negligible that people don't want to throw money
movies
at.
Movies is different.
Big difference.
Are totally different. Yeah.
But when I was talking about my Broadway career, I really liked Broadway. All the recording studios in Manhattan were based around the theaters, so I got to see all the shows. I saw Funny Girl and I saw Fiddler on the Roof.
You grew up in that.
Right.
You grew up.
I always wanted to get involved. So a friend of mine once I met at a party, a guy named James Lipton, who now has the Actors Studio interview show. He's a wonderful man. James came to me and said, would you be interested in producing some Broadway shows? I have this show. And we did a show, a black drama called The Mighty Gents, which was very, very important on Broadway. Uh-huh. And it was my first show. It didn't do very well, but I was very proud of it.
Dramatic.
Yes. Second show he came to me, he said, let's do this show. Go see it at the Manhattan Theater Club. It's called Ain't Misbehavin'.
Musical.
And I saw Ain't Misbehavin'. I saw Nell Carter doing her great bit. And
that
I saw
made her.
And Andre DeShields and Ken Page and Charlotte Wooder and all these great, great artists in it. And I said, we must get this to Broadway. So got together with my friend Emmanuel Eisenberg and some other great producers, and it ended up on Broadway. Ran for 2.5 years.
Wow.
And it's still running. It just was here down at the Amundsen after 33 years. So a good show really gets around.
Keeps going. Right.
Yes.
But you did lesser.
Yes, I also went to England, and I saw a show at the Mermaid Theatre in England, where it was called
Children
of a Lesser God, and a lot of my friends said to me, you shouldn't do this, nobody wants to see a show like this.
That got a Tony Best Award,
It won the Best Drama of the Year, and it won 2 Tonys for the actor and actresses that were in it, and it became a film with Marlee Matlin. And
she was
a beautiful film.
That
was her debut. So I'm very proud to be associated with it. I did about 10, 12 shows in a period of 3 years. Did a few Neil Simon shows. And I was very fortunate that my friends kept throwing shows at me.
Tell me about this great, great lady. I love her. And she's just one of the great singers of all times. We have Melissa Manchester.
Well, Melissa was in our group. She was one of the, first of all, she was in Bette Midler's group, the Harlettes. Then she was in Barry Manilow's group, backing him up. We did some demos together. She was always singing backgrounds for us. And Melissa just starred at the Orleans Hotel in Las Vegas with a good friend of mine, Imelda Papin, Filipino star I know. And she just sold out three nights. So she's one of the great voices. Her Don't Cry Out Loud is one of the best vocal performances ever.
Get your name on that chart. You've been on that chart a long time.
Well, you off know, and on, many years.
Years.
You know, I feel very blessed that
you
people still like it.
You got a lot of rewards,
like
young
you.
Man.
Thank you.
Now you're doing something. What are you doing now, right now?
Well, right now I'm producing other artists and I'm performing.
Oh, are producing other artists.
Yes,
still
I'm
doing it.
Still doing it. A new album has come out with one of my legendary friends, Trini Lopez.
Trini
Lopez. It's called El Immortal. And it's got all these great songs on it, these cover songs that he wanted to do. And I'm very proud of this album. It even has a Spanish version of Sugar Sugar on it that he did for me. And that came out really fun.
And this is brand new.
Brand new.
It's,
this year. This is the new one.
Any store.
You can buy it
store.
On iTunes, Amazon.com. And,
really?
You can
tell me about your Ron Dante's California Weekend.
Well,
what
I
is
always,
that?
Yeah, I always wanted to do an album that was dedicated to California and the Southern California sound. So I did songs like The Summer Wind, All Summer Long. In fact, the Beach Boys are on All Summer Long with
me.
A friend of mine, Peter Noon from Herman's Hermits, is on another song with me. My friend Andy Kim, who wrote Sugar Sugar, is on Rock Me Gently on it. But all the songs kind of feel like the California sound. I wanted to dedicate it to all my friends in Southern California.
You miss New York?
You know, I like it a lot, but I think I've done as much as I could in New York City, and I really love this part of the country. There's an excitement.
I never did. I lived here as a child. I can't stand California. I'd rather live in Manhattan. Because Manhattan, you know, I'm a New Yorker like you, baby.
Well, it's got great energy, and I love the city, and I will go back and live there someday. But for the time being, I'm really enjoying driving myself around.
You like to drive.
Yes,
see, I don't drive.
Yeah.
I don't drive at all. That's probably why, I don't know. But tell me about your commercials. You've done so many commercials. Wow, singing commercials.
Well, as I said, I've had three or four careers, and one of them was as jingle. I was a jingle singer.
Singer.
And
right.
I got to sing for the biggest products of all time. I got to sing for Budweiser Beer, Here Comes the King, McDonald's, Coke, Pepsi,
so
Dr.
Pepper. You're a pretty rich boy, Ron Dante. I mean, come on. You got, with all those things you've been doing.
Yeah. Well, I was fortunate enough to be in the right place at the right time, and I also realized at a very early age that you can make money singing and support yourself and do the things you really want to do. So when commercials came along, I was very happy to be a part of the groups that were called in to do these commercials.
I want to show my audience this picture. Look at you and Barry Manilow. This is when you were very young there. Look how young you both are.
Yeah, well,
and this is today.
Yes, this
Look
is our picture
you.
Today. This
wow.
was taken a few months ago at the Hilton, where he's playing for the last 4 years.
In Vegas.
Yeah.
He's been there for 4 years.
4 years, yeah.
How does he like it there?
He loves it.
Isn't
he
it?
Loves the idea of being in one place and letting his fans come to him instead of knocking around on the road, which can get very, very tedious at times. But he's still out there. He'll go out there and perform, but he loved being ensconced at the Hilton. They gave him Elvis's digs upstairs, and he said it was like you could feel it. It's the Elvis showroom, and it's Elvis's suite. You know, he could feel the ghosts.
When I see Barry Manilow, I think of a little boy. I don't know why. Always a little boy, and I'm thinking you look just like him too. Look, you
well,
guys
we,
are little boys.
We kind of stay. The music keeps us young.
Is that what it is?
The music keeps you young.
That's
you get up every day with something to do. It gives you something to get up for. It's always different. Every time I sing a song, even if I sing the same song, it's always different. I'm a different person when I go to that lyric.
Right.
And I think Barry feels the same way. He loves performing. I mean, he's the kind of guy who performs ever since I've known him for 33, 4 years. He does New Year's Eve. He sings on New Year's Eve.
Uh-huh.
That's what he wants to do. You know, and he has all his
Most
friends
Most entertainers
around.
Don't like to sing on New Year's Eve.
That's right.
One thing I don't like.
Yeah.
On New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
Tell me about your songwriting.
Well, I've written for, it's funny, I've written for numerous artists like James Darren, Gene
Good
Pitney,
singer too.
Yeah, Gene Pitney, Jay and the Americans, Gary Lewis and the Playboys. Lots of people have recorded. Frank Sinatra Jr. recorded one of my songs. So I've had my songs recorded over the years, but it seems like my production and my performing took over from my writing. So
right.
I still try to write, and I still try, like I just, last year we wrote a brand new Archie's Christmas album featuring
right.
Betty and Veronica, so I got to write some new songs
for that.
Got a
new Christmas album coming
yes,
out.
Yes, and it'll be out again this year, yeah.
Uh-huh.
So I'm really happy about that.
Barry Mandelow, let's get back with Barry. What kind of guy really is Barry? Privately, just simpatico, yeah. He's what?
Like, Mandelow is one of the best people to have as a friend. He's as loyal as the day is long. He will do anything for you. When it gets to his profession, he loves his profession. And he's one of the background musicians. He really wanted to be Henry Mancini when he started
really?
Out. He mentioned that to me. He would have
piano player.
Piano so. Player, arranger.
Yeah.
He wanted to be
That's
Nelson Riddle.
Yeah.
And this career just exploded for him when uh-huh. we did Mandy.
Is he happy?
He's very happy with it. He's very thrilled. This is what he wanted to do with his life. And now he's written some Broadway shows.
Uh-huh.
And he will continue. He's working on a brand new album with a little more rock in it.
Uh-huh.
So he's expanding. But basically, he's the best friend you can have. And he's a really talented guy for the band. He can tell every musician in the band what to play and how to play it.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Do you give advice, like, to certain artists, when you meet a certain artist, as a producer, you say, come here, young man, I want to help you or something like that. Do you give advice at all?
Well, I try to if there's an opening, because a lot of young artists are very defined already.
What do you think of the young artists today?
Well, yeah, some are very good. There's some really good and fun singers around. I think out of all the genres, I like country. Because there's a lot of beautiful singers there and great artists that sing real songs.
Uh-huh.
And that's what I gravitate to, is a really good song. I mean, there are some
that's
fine
singers.
That's most
important, the song.
Yes, the song is most important. You start with that. In the beginning, the song makes the artist. And then
right.
afterwards, the artist makes the song
uh-huh.
in final account. And I think today's people are getting a little away from that. They want instant stardom instead of working for it.
Uh-huh.
They want one night and on TV, and all of a sudden they're super popular. Mm-hmm. But some of them are going to find that it's very difficult to maintain because they're out there alone.
Right.
Yeah.
Ron Dante, you were out there alone as a young guy going room to room at the Brill Building. Would you say you got lucky?
Yes, definitely. Luck plays
That's
a big.
That's luck.
Yes, luck
it's
plays.
Luck.
There are a lot of guys who sang like I did.
Yeah.
And looked like I did, but they weren't in that spot when Don Kirshner, who was a great music
right.
publisher in the '60s, saw him. I was right in. I was
the
at
timing,
the right time.
The
yeah.
luck. That's
exactly.
That's
yeah. Luck
that's
plays
what
a
makes.
Big. You've got to. Donald Trump once said, "You've got to have the goods, though."
Oh yes.
Okay.
Yes.
You've got to be able to handle it when it comes, or when preparation mm-hmm. meets opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I tried to do. I really, every time I came back from the Brill Building and I got a no,
uh-huh.
I would, on the ferry boat, I would say, I'd look at the big city fading in the background.
Right.
As I went back home, I said, tomorrow I'll come, I'll be better.
Mm-hmm.
And I tried to up my game. That was all I could do.
And you worked the clubs all over Manhattan, didn't you?
Yeah, I worked all the clubs. I did as much as I could in the tri-state area. But I must say, the music publishers really tied my time up.
That's the
yeah, because they made, not only was I singing my songs, but I was singing songs for Carole King and Jerry Goffin, Barry uh-huh. Mann and Cynthia Wilde, these great, Howie Greenfield and Neil Sedaka. They'd need somebody to sing backgrounds or sing leads. I was doing
so
their
you
backgrounds.
You got lucky right in there with that group.
I was very
you
lucky.
See, and I love certain people, stars, are they don't think they're luck. The luck
oh,
is it.
Please, luck.
They don't think they're like Jack Carter, great comic,
right?
But he's bitter. Why should Jack Carter be bitter? He shouldn't be bitter. He should be happy because he's a great comedian. He's done it. He's had great luck in his life. But you're not bitter. You never will be bitter because you know who you are now.
Well,
do you really know who you are?
Well, I kind of know. Every day I get up, I feel a little different. But I do know that I have a base that I can work from. And my
right.
base is music and is singing and producing. So as long as I know I can do this, I will do it to the best of my ability every day.
How about a book? How about explaining in a book to let people know in your memoir? You're a very young guy. I'm looking at you. You're very young to be... You know, to be where you are.
I'm going to be like Jack Benny. I'm going to stay 39 for the rest of my life.
Right, right.
But I would love to write a book someday. I would love it to be the right type.
Using that word someday.
Yeah.
See, someday it just should be right away.
Well.
You know, Because people say someday and they don't, they never get through it.
I'm worried about the fact that another music business story might not be that interesting, that's all.
There are many
music business stories out there, and I don't take myself that seriously. That's why I always have fun doing what I'm doing and where I'm going.
Yeah. Well, I think another book would be, for you, come with a book, it would be great.
Well, you never can tell, maybe a Broadway show in there.
That's it. That's it.
Because I've touched my career has touched on everybody else's career, so it could integrate all the other great
what
stars.
What made Sammy run? Mm-hmm. What made Ron Dante run? I think that could be a title right there for your book or your Broadway show. You know?
Because
you went there to the Brill Building as a young guy and you ran from place to place, up floor to floor. That's what made Don Ronte run.
That's what they used to call me, Don Ronte. Sometimes they would reverse Dante. My name. It's as long as they spell it right.
You're Italian boy.
Yes, I am.
Your parents speak Italian?
My dad spoke a little Italian. Uh-huh. They were both Napolitan.
Staten Island.
Yes, very good. Staten Island Italian. We ran the island.
I'm a Siciliano.
Yes, we're paisano.
Yeah, half Italian.
Yes, and I'm very proud of my heritage. It's a great heritage.
It is.
And
great.
I'm very proud of coming from Staten Island, which is a great place to grow up. It prepared me for the world. Because it wasn't soft. You had to really achieve. And it were great people there, and my uncles and my aunts, and my mom is still there.
A lot of people are moving to Staten Island now because they can't afford Manhattan, and they moved to Staten Island. But Staten Island is getting high now, too.
A little bit. The great thing about Staten Island is it overlooks Manhattan. Certain areas, South Beach. And the other places have great views, and you only pay half of what you pay for that view in New York City.
Yeah, who cares about the view? I don't care about the view. So this book, had the record here of California Weekend, is out now.
Yes.
They can get this at anywhere, right?
California Weekend is out now. They can find it on iTunes. They can find it on Amazon.com. They can find it in the bookstores.
I love this summer in the summer wind. The wind,
Beautiful song. Sinatra did a great version.
A friend of mine, Dick Roman, a singer. I think you probably knew him.
Yes,
Dick Roman, who gave me my name, Skippy Lowe. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, you didn't know. Sammy LaBella was my real name. And if you're a boy out there, I'll give you an autographed copy. I wrote a book. See, I wrote a book.
I'd love to see it.
Yes, and my book is called The Boy with the Betty Grable Legs. It's a crazy title. But that's me as a little boy.
That's great, man.
And this is my book.
Great.
And guess what? It's a showbiz memoir. And you've got to write a book, Ron.
Well, maybe you can help me.
I can help you because you can talk on the tape recorder. Mm. That's all you have to do. Yeah. Turn the tape recorder at night. You're at home. Think what you've been doing and talk. And then someone write it in the papers and that's it.
I might do that.
So tell me about this wonderful club that you're going to be going into. It's in the
Normandy Casino.
Normandy Casino. Tell me about that.
Yes, I'll be playing the Normandy Casino September 5th, Saturday night.
Uh-huh.
And it'll be Ron Dante and friends. I'm going to have my friend Alan O'Day, who sang Undercover Angel, will be there singing, sitting in.
That'll be fun.
Will be Bo Donaldson and the Haywoods, a great band. They had a big hit called Billy Don't Be a Hero.
Uh-huh.
They'll be performing for most of the night with me. So come on down. I hope everybody comes down. It's a great room. It's a classic room.
It is. It's an old type of nightclub room, isn't it? Cabaret. I love it. We have one here in L.A. I didn't know. It's called the M Bar. You heard of the M Bar?
I've heard of it, yes. I haven't played it.
You haven't played it, but it's a great room. Uh-huh. I went there to see Frank Stallone there, Sly's brother.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great cabaret room. Seats maybe 150 people, but we don't have them in town, cabaret rooms.
Yeah.
The Roosevelt Hotel, the Cine Girls closed. God. Did you ever play that?
No, never played there.
The Catalina?
No, haven't played any of these places. I would love to.
The Catalina is a good room.
Yeah.
Eartha Kitt, when she was alive, she used to work it all the time there. So you grew up in Staten Island, left there, came to Hollywood.
Yeah.
You're happy here. You live alone. You're married or what? What's happening?
I live alone. I'm married. I'm in a relationship.
Well, see, girl, you're in a relationship now.
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
So that's good. I'm not trying to push you. I mean, I'm just trying.
It doesn't matter. I'm proud of it. Yes.
I just heard Barry Manilow's not married. I didn't know that.
No, Barry's never been married. He decided. I think his career came first.
The careers.
Yeah, I think his career
the careers
came first.
Always come first.
Sure.
Is that you too, you feel?
No. I've tried it a couple of times. It didn't work out. But marriage. But it's tough.
Oh, you've been married. Yes. I see.
Twice. Uh-huh. And I just think it's tough to maintain a career and a private life. It's a delicate balance, as they say.
Uh-huh. Are you an actor also?
No, I've never acted. I'm singing is in my heart.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I see. Okay, that's good.
But I wouldn't mind acting. I wouldn't mind it. I think singing a song is very much like acting. I mean, you can't do that lyric.
What did you thought about the Copacabana? That's such a big, big number. It came. Did you thought it would be that big?
Well, at first I was a little worried that it would be too musical. Not musical, but like a musical
like
comedy.
Like a comedy, yeah.
Yes, like a comedy. And I thought...
You thought it was going to be like him putting the turban of Carmen Miranda.
I thought it was going to be like Desi Arnaz.
Yes, yeah.
And of course, that after all the hits he had had with Could It Be Magic, I Write the Songs, trying to get the feeling to come out of that into a comical thing, it wouldn't have worked. So we both worked really hard to make it pop-oriented and danceable. And I must say, the night we finished one of the mixes in New York City, we went to the Copacabana, which had become a disco at the time.
Right.
And about midnight, we asked the DJ to put on our version and our new hit, our new record, Copacabana. Uh-huh. And at first, everybody stopped dancing. And we got worried for about 10 seconds. And then somebody started to do a wonderful move, and the whole dance floor caught on. And Barry said, all right, we've got it. This is going to be a hit dance record. And he was right.
And this was at the Copacabana.
Yes, at the Copacabana in New York.
Great. Yeah. That's great. Isn't that fun? Tell me about John Denver. I love John Denver. He was such a special, special man. You handled him for a while.
Actually, I worked with him on a TV special. I got to record two or three of his hits for a Barry Manilow TV special where he was the special guest star. So I got to know him because we had to recreate his hits in the studio.
Right,
so
right.
He came in. I must say he was one of the strongest singers I've ever worked with.
Really?
Just a strong singer. On the set when we were taping him, we must have done 8 or 9 takes on one song because they wanted to get different camera angles. And he kept singing and singing with all the emotion and all the strength of one of the, I just was amazed at how strong he was. He's a great loss.
When you met Cher, she must have loved you right away.
Cher and I got along great.
She had to.
We got along great, and she would call me at 2 or 3 in the morning and say, I've written a song about my ex-husband. It's called Too Far Gone. What do you think? It was about Greg Allman.
And
sure enough, she sang it to me like at 3 in the morning. And the next day, we recorded it. And we put it on her Take Me Home album. She was a delight to work with. She was one of the boys, almost.
She really is.
She came in to work. She always showed up on time. She loved to be in the studio and sing. I remember Sonny came in at one point. Mm-hmm. And she was kind of tense when he came in a little bit. Critiquing her new stuff, and she wanted to be in control of her new stuff. He was involved with her any longer.
Right, right.
And so, Sonny left, and she seemed to sing much better after he left. And then, of course, Gene Simmons, she was dating, came in a couple of days later, checked me out to make sure everything was, professional. And it was. Gene's a good friend. I love Gene.
Who's your favorite? You have a favorite of all of them?
Well, it's tough. Yeah, it's tough.
Is it tough? I shouldn't throw that at you.
Yeah.
It's not nice.
Yeah, because every person I work with, every artist I work with, they're like my children almost. I love what I did with them. I'm proud of it. You really get connected to the number ones, though. And the number one records, Manilow and I did.
Manilow meant a lot to me.
Yes,
right.
It meant a lot to me.
Ron Dante, it's been such a pleasure talking to you, knowing you. Thank you.
Thank you. It went off?
Yeah.
Good. Sorry we missed that. But you did say it was good talking to you, and then it cut off. It was perfect.